Greetings and welcome. We are in Junior English, and our objective for the hour now is to turn to the analysis and study of texts that we will assign the title of Native American texts. Now that's an interesting term. Let's write it in our notes. Native American texts. What does the term even mean? Native American texts. Well, there's an understanding that when we begin a study of American thought and American literature, we are met with a very difficult challenge. What will we constitute as the beginning of America? Now we'll play this game, and you might as well kind of put it on, you know, on your paper as well. We'll play this game where we're going to talk about history in a certain kind of word picture that looks kind of like something that we derive out of a math class, where we draw a little line, we put a line down the center, we put a zero there, don't we? We talk about events which occur before the Common Era. We talk about events that we will call Common Era or AD. Then on this history timeline, we will divide the timeline up by 100-year segments, going both directions from the zero, correct? Now, what do we call those 100-year segments? We call them centuries, yes? 100-year divisions, centuries. So, for example, right now, we sit at what year as I give this lecture? It is the year what? 2014. Which means what? That means 2014 years ago, something happened that we qualify on our timeline as zero. What is that something happened, by the way? We celebrate that every December, don't we? On the 25th. What important event are we celebrating that constitutes the zero? In Western timeline history, it is, of course, the birth of Christ, correct? So you want to write that down. So the birth of Christ. So we talk about events which occur before the Common Era, the birth of Christ, and events which occur after the Common Era. Sometimes in the old days, we talked about this as AD, all right? Now, in the same way that in math class, you count down towards zero, the same is true as well in our timeline. So, for example, an important date in history is 399 BCE. That's the year that they jacked Socrates, the great Greek philosopher, okay? In 399. 399 years before the birth of Christ. For those of you that in your sophomore year have already studied Shakespeare's classic play called Julius Caesar, about that guy that gets jacked by his best friend, you'll recall, that jacking happened in what year? It happened in 44 BCE, 44 years before the birth of Christ. So you can see how we're counting down from 399 to 44, right? Then we hit zero, then we start counting up. Right now we are in 2014, and we call this the 21st century. By the way, that's how we'll write it in our notes, where you put the 2-1, the ST, and then you put a large C around it to designate century. Okay? So we can play a game when we do this kind of thing. For example, Columbus sailed the ocean blue in, what is it? 1492, right? We're going to write that date down. Columbus sailed the ocean blue in 1492. What century? Well, now, wait a minute. If I'm in 2014 now, and I go up a number to get to my century, correct? 21st century. If I'm in 1492, I got to go up one number, so I'm in what century? You're right, the 15th century. Now, question. Some students will often say, I don't understand this. Why isn't 1492 just the 14th century? Like, it would make it so much easier. You know what I'm saying? If 1492 was just the 14th century, how come it's the 15th century? That is confusing to me. The answer is simple. We start at zero with the birth of Christ, and we start counting up. 50 years after the birth of Christ, 60 years, 80, 90, 95, 96, 98, 99, 100, that's the first century, first 100 years after the birth of Christ, right? Then 150, 180, 195, 198, 199, 200, that is the second century, second 100 years, even though the years begin with 150, 180. Do you got me? So when we hit 1492, we're actually talking about the 15th century. Makes sense. But now we're going to ask a more interesting and germane question to our text. That is, when do you start counting American history? Well, now that's an interesting question. Technically, we will often refer to the birth of America when Tommy and his pals sat down and wrote that famous document that says, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, all men are created equal, and endowed by their creator with a certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." You'll maybe remember those. Wait a minute, those words come from what classic document in American history? Tom Jefferson and his pals wrote a document where they said, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, all men are created equal, and are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights." What is the document where that appears that we call the what? Declaration of Independence. Written in what year? Whoa, let's see if you can write that date down. What is the year when the Declaration of Independence was written? Oh, by the way, we always celebrate it every year on a special day in the summer when we get to eat lots of hot dogs and all that stuff, right? What is the date in the year we always celebrate this? It's usually attended with lots of fireworks, isn't it? We call it what? July the, correct? It's the 4th of July. But what year was that document written that ostensibly begins us thinking about American history? Does anybody know? We are in 1776. Boy, oh boy, was that an important year for us. We want to write that one down, right? 1776. And we kind of call that year the beginning of our American nation. But now follow my question. Is that the beginning of America? See, is that the beginning of America? 1776. Oh, by the way, 1776, what century? See, what century? Well, if I'm going 2014 up to 21, if I'm going 1492 up to 115 century, then if I'm going 17, I'm going up one number, I'm in the what century? I'm in the 18th century. Does that make sense? So, was there an America before 1776? Well, that is a very difficult question. How will you define it? What will be the beginnings of America? Because we're aware that before 1776, there were lots and lots of people who were coming to the area that we call the 13 colonies. We'll talk about that as we get into our conversations in here. So at what point do you say America begins? Because when those people showed up from Europe, especially England, there were already people living here. There were millions of people living here. Lots of them speaking lots of different languages, having their own kind of government, politics. We call those people Native Americans. What does that term mean to you? Native Americans. What does it mean to say that somebody is native or indigenous to the population? Ostensibly, we mean, of course, they were there earlier than the white people who arrived, right? So in other words, we're going to talk about a time period when there were people already living on this continent, but they weren't from Europe. They weren't white-skinned. Long before anybody with white skin shows up on this place, there are people who've been living here for a long, how long? Long time. Really long. And it's fascinating to talk about who these people are. For example, right now today, you can go out into Arizona in the middle of nowhere and you can start talking with old tribal leaders and they'll tell you stories about large trees that are packed so close together that you can't see the sky for days of walking, and their hero jumps from branches to branches over the tops of the treetops as their hero of their story they make up. And you ask these people, dude, in Arizona, I don't know if you've been down there lately, but there ain't no trees. And there certainly ain't no trees that are so tall you can't see the sky. Where did these stories come from? These people originally are not from Arizona. These people are originally from the area we call New England, namely New York, where, guess what? There are forests that are really dense and really high trees. Wait a minute, that's a long ways. Dude, you get a car right now and drive from New York City out to Phoenix. It's gonna take you more than a day to get there. Where did these people, why come these people are all the way out in Arizona? Well, we know why. Because they started on the eastern seaboard in the area we know of as New York now. They ended up migrating, going further and further west. How come? Well, that's going to be part of the American story. That when the Europeans arrive, already there's people living here. These people have lives. These people have stories. And those stories tell us a lot about who they are. We're going to turn to, now, three of these stories. Now, obviously, there's a whole lot more than that. Your textbook anthology has just selected three to give us a sense of what these people were kind of like. Now let's turn in your hymnal to page 18, 19, and of course page 20. Our first titles, as we look at them, we don't have authors. You want to write that down. We don't have an author. Why? Because these are what we call oral stories. What does that mean? Well, they weren't written down, they were spoken. They were spoken texts, okay? And they are attributed to different tribes of Native Americans, okay? The Onondaga will tell us a story about the origin of the world. The Modoc will also have a story for us, and then finally we have a Navajo story, all right? So we're gonna look at three of these stories. Now we're going to begin on page 18 under literary analysis for you at 2B. And we want to point out something. What does it mean to talk about an origin myth? Let's get the word myth out of the way really quickly, because sometimes this word can be an uncomfortable word, myth. When we use the term as academics, we do not mean a lie. So for example, somebody says in the middle of July, dude, it's snowing outside, and you go, don't make up a myth. That means a lie. That's not how we use this term. The term myth, write it in your notes, the term myth simply means the following. A story to explain the unexplainable. A story to explain the unexplainable. You don't understand how something happens, you make up a story. We will call that a myth. In many ways, of course, myths are early science. The attempt to try to explain things people do not understand. The Greeks did it all the time. Why is it every morning you wake up, the sun's in the same spot? Well, you understand it today as the rotation of the earth and all of that jazz around the sun. The Greeks didn't understand it that way. How did they explain it? They made up a story about some god named Apollo who drags the sun through the sky. The ponies who are dragging the sun through the sky get tired, which is why they have to rest, and then you hook them back up again the next day. That will explain the notion of why it is the sun always seems to come out of the same spot. Do you got me? What does origin mean? You've written that word down as well. What does that mean? Origin, we're talking about cosmogonic myths. Now that's an interesting word. Cosmogonic, coming from our word cosmos, which of course means beginnings. Origin myths try to explain how everything began. It's what we will call the Genesis stories. And of course, if you pick up, for example, a King James version of the Bible, the 1611 King James version of the Bible, went to Sunday school maybe, or church, you know that if you open that book called the Holy Bible up, the very first book of that Bible is called Genesis. That is to say, origins. That is to say, where everything started. How did it all begin? Question, before we now turn to our first of these stories, why would anybody care about this? Jot down an answer to that in your notes. Why would anybody care about where you come from? Well, it's interesting, and let's try and give a couple of answers as to why. One, human beings, it seems, are inquisitive creatures. What does that mean? We like to know the answers to stuff, huh? We like to understand why things happen. Cosmogonic myths, origin myths, can tell us something, maybe to give us an answer to that. Two, we have a tendency, as human beings, to want to try to explain the future. Where are we going? How will things look? What will it be like tomorrow? Interestingly, a lot of the way you see the world has to do with the way you see the beginning of the world. Okay? Three, origin myths are told to a group of people to bring them together. Everybody believes the same story. You're not allowed to not believe the story in the early days of a beginning of a culture. When we look, for example, at early American thought, you're not allowed to debate whether the opening chapters of the book of Genesis are true or not. You're not allowed to debate that. If you end up wanting to debate that, you end up as toast on a post. In other words, soap on a rope. They will jack your can, right? You have to accept the story. End of discussion, period, right? As a culture begins to become older, to mature, its myths can be challenged. Of course, we call that the process of science, don't we, right? And the scientific method. We don't read the stories about the beginnings of origins. We don't read those stories to argue whether they're right or wrong. We read them to try to understand something about the culture that produced them. So you want to write this down. It's a simple question. What does this origin myth tell us is important to the culture that produced it? What does it tell us about these people that made up this story? Okay. The first one of these stories is going to be from the Onondaga tribe. Okay. Notice on page 19, I'm just reading it with you on page 19. The Onondaga were key members of the Five Nations, or the Iroquois Confederacy, in what is now upstate New York. So in other words, the story we're about to listen to and read comes from what we today know of as New York State, okay, way up in New England. Like other Iroquois, they lived in villages of wood and bark, long houses occupied by related families. After siding with the British during the American Revolution, some of the Onondaga left for Canada after the British defeat. However, the majority returned to their ancestral valley in central New York State near the lake that bears their name. Now, the story that we're going to look at is called The Earth on a Turtle's Back. Okay? Now, I want to point out something important on page 20. Do you notice that right under the title it says that this is, of course, an Onondaga woodlands, northeast woodlands story. But do you see the word retold there? Do you see that? Retold by. Now, what's that all about? Because these stories were not originally written down. They were told from one person to the next. Ah, important for your notes. Not just any person. Not just any person. A very special person. Now, if you're familiar with Lois Lowry's classic text, The Giver, you understand how she plays a game that's very, very old. What is that game? It says, name the most important person in your town. That's a fun game to play. If everybody in Worland had to get jacked but one person, who would be that one person? And everybody gets to choose. So in other words, everybody gets to choose, we all vote, and there's one person who gets to live and everybody else has to get jacked in this town. How would you pick? See, that's an interesting question. Well, you would probably pick by interest of significance. Would you agree with me? You would ask this question, who's the most important person in our town and why? For example, is it the person who has the most money? Is it the person who's the oldest? Is it the person who's the youngest? Is it the person who's the strongest? Is it the person who's the weakest? See, this is an interesting question. Native Americans answered this question this way. the most important person in the tribe, the most important person in the village, was the person who knew the stories. The stories. Why were the stories important? Because the stories could explain and answer the questions of the past and the future. Got me? So when we hear retold here, we're talking about individuals who have been handed down the story. Finally, these stories get written down. Got me? What's one of the problems with writing down a lot of these early stories? These tribes spoke a language they often did not write. They did not have a written language. They felt like they didn't need a written language. They spoke, right? Which is why, when you read in history, that, for example, there were lots of early fights in those early days when whole tribes of people were wiped out, whole villages were completely destroyed, or even worse, germs came in, bacteria, the smallpox which arrived, and within a matter of days, everybody in the entire town or village could die. What was tragic about that was that when the last person died, the stories died. Often, are you ready for this? The language died. Nobody left to speak the language. Nobody left to understand how to speak the language. The end of cultures could sometimes happen because none of the material of their stories written down. So there's an interest, obviously into the 20th century, of trying to get a lot of these stories written down. Where, for example, I've been a part of some of these projects, you go and you sit down with this really, really old woman. Maybe she lives in a hut in the middle of nowhere, Arizona or New Mexico. First of all, you got to figure out a way to get her to say, yeah, she'll even talk to you. Because a lot of times, she doesn't even want to talk to you. Gee, I wonder why. There is a history there, right? If you can finally sit down with her, you say to her, usually, of course, through some translator, tell us your story. A lot of times she'll say, no. Only my people know my stories, our stories, only our people. Yeah, but if you tell us your story, we can write it down so lots of people can read it and understand more about your culture. Why do they want to know that? Why do they need to know that? Only our culture needs to know about our culture. We don't want to share those secrets. It takes a lot of work to finally get somebody to finally open up. But then here's the final problem. She starts telling you the story, but she's telling the story in her language through a translator. And all of a sudden the translator will stop and will give you, the one recording this information in English, a strange look and says, we don't really have a word for that in English. What do you mean you don't have a word for that in English? Yeah, we don't have a word for that. I don't know what to say. She just told me something. I know what it means because I'm part of this culture, but I can't explain it to you. And you go, what do you mean you can't explain it to me? You speak English. Just tell me what it is in English. I would, but you don't have a word for it in English. How is that possible? I thought English had all the words. Not even kind of. Not even a little bit. There are all kinds of words on this planet you can't put into English. And then, of course, the old lady will say, they're too beautiful for your language. Of course, the old lady will probably suggest, if you really want to know, why don't you learn our language? You expect us to learn your language? Why doesn't it work the other way? Because we're Americans. To which she will report, I was an American long before you were. And I'm still an American. You're a foreigner. Whoa! And it's at that point that the old lady ends the interview. And she says, in the end, I'm the only American. You're just on borrowed time. I'm the real American. That's why we call them native. By the way, her argument is a knockdown argument. That is a knockdown argument, by the way. The only way to argue against that is to say, well, yeah, but we took it from you and now it's our land. Well, yeah, that's right. That's right. But that's not a very good argument, is it? Of course, it's better to have some of the stories written down so we can at least read them. Now, we don't read these stories again to argue. We don't read them to go, shh, really? Somebody actually thought this? This is about the stupidest asinine. No. You're missing it. We don't read these stories for fact. We read these stories to understand a people who would produce a story like this. Well, let's look at the first one, okay? The first of our stories starts on page 20. And we're going to make a couple of quick observations. First of all, this is a story that's going to talk about the creation of the world. You might want to write that term down. The creation of the world. Now, that's an interesting concept. I teach this sometimes to students. They're kind of blown away. Do you realize when you say that the world was created, that means that the world wasn't always this way? It wasn't always this way. In other words, there was a time when the world didn't exist, and then all of a sudden, it does exist. How did it get here? Well, it was created. Of course, think of it. If you're going to have something created, you have to have a creator. That is to say, somebody made it. Right? So that's going to beg a really interesting question. Who is that somebody? Of course, often in certain cultures, that somebody is referenced as a god or a deity or deities, right? It can be more than one. So as we get into the story, we're going to ask an interesting question. What does this story seem to suggest about two things? One, the creator, the originator. Two, how it was created. The process. How does the world get made? We're now going to listen to the actual text itself. I want you to follow along. I highly, highly recommend that you try and follow along with the tip of a writing utensil. How well can you keep up with the flow of the words? If you are struggling to keep up, then you need to work on your reading speed a little bit. On the other hand, if you can stay up, that'll help you focus. That'll help you try to understand what's being said. Now, after we finish, we'll do a quick annotation where we will ask summary, level one, meanings, level two, and a little bit of rhetoric, and then finally maybe make some observations at 3A, 3B as well, all right? So here we go. We're starting on page 20. Let's go ahead now and listen to this text be read, all right? So just follow along.
The Earth on Turtle's Back, Onondaga. Retold by Michael J. Caduto and Joseph Bruschak. Before this Earth existed, there was only water. It stretched as far as one could see, and in that water there were birds and animals swimming around. Far above, in the clouds, there was a skyland. In that skyland there was a great and beautiful tree. It had four white roots which stretched to each of the sacred directions, and from its branches all kinds of fruits and flowers grew. There was an ancient chief in the skyland. His young wife was expecting a child, and one night she dreamed that she saw the great tree uprooted. The next day she told her husband the story. He nodded as she finished telling her dream. "My wife," he said, "I am sad that you had this dream. It is clearly a dream of great power, and as is our way, when one has such a powerful dream, we must do all we can to make it true. The great tree must be uprooted." Then the ancient chief called the young men together and told them that they must pull up the tree. But the roots of the tree were so deep, so strong, that they could not budge it. At last, the ancient chief himself came to the tree. He wrapped his arms around it, bent his knees, and strained. At last, with one great effort, he uprooted the tree and placed it on its side. Where the tree's roots had gone deep into the skyland, there was now a big hole. The wife of the chief came close and leaned over to look down, grasping the tip of one of the great tree's branches to steady her. It seemed as if she saw something down there, far below, glittering like water. She leaned out further to look, and as she leaned, she lost her balance and fell into the hole. Her grasp slipped off the tip of the branch, leaving her with only a handful of seeds as she fell down, 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 down. Far below, in the waters, some of the birds and animals looked up. "Someone is falling toward us from the sky," said one of the birds. "We must do something to help her," said another. Then two swans flew up. They caught the woman from the sky between their wide wings. Slowly, they began to bring her down toward the water, where the birds and animals were watching. "She is not like us," said one of the animals. "Look, she doesn't have webbed feet. I don't think she can live in the water." What shall we do then? Said another of the water animals. I know, said one of the water birds. I have heard that there is earth far below the waters. If we dive down and bring up earth, then she will have a place to stand. So the birds and animals decided that someone would have to bring up earth. One by one, they tried. The duck dove first, some say. He swam down and down, far beneath the surface, but could not reach the bottom and floated back up. Then the beaver tried. He went even deeper, so deep that all was dark, but he could not reach the bottom either. The loon tried, swimming with his strong wings. He was gone a long, long time, but he, too, failed to bring up earth. Soon it seemed that all had tried and all had failed. Then a small voice spoke. I will bring up earth or die trying. They looked to see who it was. It was the tiny muskrat. She dove down and swam and swam. She was not as strong or as swift as the others, but she was determined. She went so deep that it was all dark, and still she swam deeper. She swam so deep that her lungs felt ready to burst, but she swam deeper still. At last, just as she was becoming unconscious, she reached out one small paw and grasped at the bottom, barely touching it, before she floated up, almost dead. When the other animals saw her break the surface, they thought she had failed. Then they saw her right paw was held tightly shut. She has the earth, they said. Now where can we put it?
Place it on my back, said a deep voice.
It was the great turtle who had come up from the depths. They brought the muskrat over to the great turtle and placed her paw against his back. To this day, there are marks at the back of the turtle's shell which were made by the muskrat's paw. The tiny bit of earth fell on the back of the turtle. Almost immediately, it began to grow larger and larger and larger until it became the whole world. Then, the two swans brought the Sky Woman down. She stepped onto the new earth and opened her hand, letting the seeds fall onto the bare soil. From those seeds, the trees and grass sprang up. Life on earth had begun.
Now, this is a very interesting story.
From the Grapes of Wrath, by John
Steinbeck.
Let's
go ahead now and exegete.
The Concrete Highway.
As we were. So what exactly is it that we're going to say about this story? Let's work first at level one, then level two, and then finally level three, and then we'll see if we've learned anything at the end of our annotative work. Let's begin first of all with level one. If later on, you know, somebody were to ask you, what did you do? I was working with this text with the old man, the crazy man. Really, what text? This text about a turtle. What's it about? Can you reduce the whole story down to a couple of lines really quickly? See if you can do that in your notes. In other words, you're going to take everything you just read, and you're going to reduce it down very, very quickly to a single line. Okay? You're going to say something about what this story is fundamentally about. Of course, we got a little bit about a tree. We got a little bit about uprooting a tree. We got a little bit about looking down in the hole and falling, right? That's probably, you would argue, part one of our story, huh? Would you agree with me? Part two of the story is, of course, where are we going to put her? Who is the we that asked this question and has to go through this process of deciding where they're going to put her? Notice, interestingly, it's what? Where are the humans in this story? They don't exist, do they? Right? There are no real humans in this story, but notice all of the decision-making is being made by a bunch of animals, correct? You have several animals that try because they've heard that. Did you notice this? They've heard that down under the water, there's this stuff called Earth, which seems to suggest that in our story, everything is water. There is no land, but there's land under the water. Interestingly, several animals try. Funny thing, who is the animal that figures it out and has enough guts to go and get it done? Is it the largest animal? No. Is it the strongest animal? No. It's the one, did you notice it with the tiny? Tiny, right? It's tiny. It's the one with no size. And yet the muskrat's able to get down there, get some earth, bring it back. The Sky Woman has one in her hands. What has she brought with her? She's brought a few seeds, right, from the root of the tree that has been torn down, right? And this will allow then for the earth to grow and grow and grow. Earth had begun. Early example, early cosmogonic myth, early origination myth. Simple. Now again, we're not going to look at a story like this to argue whether it's true or false. Okay? We rather look at the story to ask some really interesting questions about who would tell a story like this? What kind of culture would tell a story like this to explain origins? And what does it tell us about that culture? Okay? By the way, notice you have several moments in the story where little references are made to they say, and you know what I'm saying? In other words, you can tell this is a story that's oral. It's been handed down. The original storytellers are now gone. They tell us that this is the way that it worked out. Now, I want to go back really quickly that we're working at level 2. And I'm interested at level 2 on page 18. Notice that we've already mentioned origination myth. But on page 18, do you see that other word in black, themes? And do you see that other word there that I want you to write down in 2B? Uh-oh, that's a really interesting word, archetypes. Archetypes. Now, what is an archetype? You might want to write down a definition right from page 18. They will tell you that an archetype is a symbol. Oh, you mean like when I go and I watch the band, and all of a sudden those guys go, psh. Is that what we mean by symbol? No. See, this is a different symbol. What do I mean by symbol? Something represents or stands for something else. Yes? Okay. So now let's ask the question about archetypes. Patterns. Character types. What do you want to say really quickly, jot down in your notes, what do you want to say about the different kinds of archetypes that you potentially see in this story? For example, notice you have a large tree. The tree is important. Why do they tear the tree down? Because she had a dream. Whoa, let's think about that for a moment. In early cultures, dreams are very important. Why? Well, there's an assumption, isn't there, that the gods or the spirits tell people things through dreams. That, by the way, is not a completely unusual idea, even into later times. So, for example, readers of, for example, religious texts like the Bible or the Quran will identify. There are lots of examples of where dreams are a way to tell important pieces of information, right? So she has a dream. In the dream, of course, there's something about tree. Why do you think trees are important to this culture if they came from upstate New York? What do we know about upstate New York? Lots of forests, huh? Right? So if you grow up where there's lots and lots of trees, you're going to maybe tell a story about trees. Okay? Then, Sky Woman, falling from the sky, right? And you have to figure out what to do with her. How is she saved? How is she saved? Who saves her, right? We've got those swans, don't we, right? So these birds are going to come and save her. But then there's the question of what to do with her. And the answer is, I think there's this stuff called earth. What do you see is interesting and write down in your notes about the different animals that try to bring up earth? Notice, for example, we have different animals attempting to do this project, right, of resurrecting earth. The first one, notice, that we're going to look at is a duck. The second is a beaver. Then a loon's going to try. None of them can do it. What do you think is significant in a culture that produces a story where the very smallest, the very weakest of animals is the one that saves the group? What message is being taught there that you can write down in 2A? What is this message about the power of the tiny? Right? Notice this is going to be a culture that will emphasize the importance of the small, not always the big. Sometimes it's going to be the tiny voice that can change things, not the big booming voice. And then finally, of course, we have the beginnings of Earth. Now let's ask a couple of interesting questions at level two. What is missing from the story in terms of an origination myth? What is missing from this story? For example, we said earlier that if the world's going to be created, it has to be created by a creator. Well, in this story, can you jot down who is the creator of this story? Okay. And notice, we don't have any humans really in this story, but we have lots of animals in this story. By the way, notice, they can all talk. Did you notice this? They can talk with each other, talking animals. And finally, what's up with the seeds falling? Gotta have seeds for what? What do you gotta have to have life? Well, you gotta have water. You gotta have land and seeds to put in the land, right? Notice that this is a story that is told by a culture that understands the importance of growing things, right? Growing things. All right, let's jump now to 3A. We always say at level three, we're looking to try to relate this story to other stories. Can you jot down at 3A at least one other text that this story relates to? Now, there's a couple of ways to go here. One way is to think about stories that are other cosmogonic stories. So, for example, what are other stories of creation or beginnings that you've heard of before? Some of them might be Christian, some of them might be non-Christian. What is, for example, the similarities between a story like this and the first three chapters of the book of Genesis? Well, no, wait a minute. It's kind of interesting. If you look at the book of Genesis, the story that is told there about the very beginnings, guess what? A tree is really important. Do you know this story? A tree in a special garden called what? What is the name of that garden? It is called Eden, isn't it? Whoa! In those origination stories, also, gardens and trees are important. Growing things are important. Also, we have talking animals in the story. In this case, from Genesis chapter 3, it's a talking snake, isn't it? Right? So we have some similarities there as well. But I want to comment on another kind of relationship. Because I've often said this to juniors, and they sometimes will say, "That's odd, I've never thought about that." Think about the movies. We have one or two of them out, in fact, right now. Movies where some kind of a power or an alien of some type shows up on human soil and nobody knows exactly what to do with that kind of power. Can you jot down a movie that you're familiar with like that? What is your favorite movie about invasion? What is your favorite movie about outsiders showing up to try to challenge the people who live here? Now that's an interesting question, because a lot of times in those stories, the people who show up, or the aliens that show up, are really strong. They're scary strong. And it takes a coming together to be able to compete to try to overthrow, right? So for example, you can have all of a sudden aliens that show up off the coast of Los Angeles, right, in a very famous show of a few years ago. And now they've got all this technology and power, but notice that the local inhabitants, in this case, of course, the American soldiers, have to find a way to fight and struggle. How are those two stories similar? The one that we just read, and these movies that you know about outside invaders coming in? Finally, let's jump really quickly to 3B. Any kind of relation that you can make to this story. Jot down really quickly one way that you can relate to this story. For example, you might think about, well, how do you answer the question where you came from? Do you have an answer to that question? Or is it still for you kind of like up in the air? Or are you inclined to say, origination stories, cosmogonic myths are a waste of time? I don't need to know where I came from. I just am interested in where I'm going to. Or are you inclined to say, I guess I've never really thought about it, but it's kind of important to know where you come from. What are your thoughts about animals? Do you like how the different animals in the story serve to symbolize or represent other kinds of things? Are you at all interested in the fact that it's the smallest that sometimes is the most powerful? It's interesting how one student once said, "This story tells a lot about high school." And one of the students went, "Dude, what are you talking about? It's a dumb story about this turtle and everything." No, this story tells a lot about high school. Because high school is kind of like this story in that when you look at people in high school, there are the populars, the ones that everybody looks up to, and they're usually the loudest, the strongest, the best looking, the richest. They're the ones, and everybody else kind of goes, I'll never be as good. They're the successful, they're the populars. But a lot of times when you come back and visit 20 years later to see who's become the most successful, guess what? A lot of times, it's the quietest who gained the great success. It's not always the populars. It's not always the loudest. It's not always the one that gets his or her way that in the end is the most successful. Sometimes, even the strongest need the weakest. There's a famous saying, a chain, if you've pulled stuff, you know this is true. A chain is only as strong as its weakest link, right? In other words, even the small are important, not just the big. Finally, archetypes. If you had to be one of the people in this story, you, who do you most identify with in this story? Who do you most identify with? Is it the woman who falls out of the sky? Is it the little muskrat that can finally do? Is it the turtle itself? Is it, see how this works? Now you're asking an interesting question. How do you relate to this story? Okay. Of course, the next time you look at a turtle, see how these stories, they're way cool. The next time you look at a turtle, you'll have a tendency to go, oh yeah, that explains why that turtle has that really beautiful design on its shell, huh?